Today on Beers TV Investigates, which par meter is best? And I think you're gonna be surprised by the results. Hi, I'm Ryan, your host of Beers TV Investigates, a weekly YouTube series which explores popular reefing theories, products, methods, what the manuals are missing with a focus on putting them to the test. This week, we're testing a variety of par meters against each other to help identify which one is the most accurate, but also provide a general expectation of accuracy. You hear a lot more talk about par meters these days because light is the number one source of nutrients for the corals, and just like alkalinity or other elements, it's almost universally accepted that the strength of the light, the amount of time it's offered, and stability of the light source can have an equally large impact on growth, coloration, and general metabolic health of the corals, again, particularly with SBS corals. Not enough light in the corals will starve or brown out trying to generate enough nutrients. Too much light in the corals bleach or can even die. Even within that, how long they're illuminated may be as important as how intense the par is. Ecotech, for instance, is currently researching the impacts of what they call DLI, or daily light intervals, meaning 150 par for 6 hours might not be all that different than 100 par for 9 hours. Since our reef tanks are living pieces of art in our homes, most of us would like to see them illuminated for fairly long periods, and stuff like this matters. In relation to that, I'd like to applaud Ecotech for stepping forward and not just offering the community solid lighting options that help us explore this universe, but behind that, making an effort to help explore how to best use this lighting in general and further the exploration of reefing. This just isn't something that many of the businesses in our industry are doing, and I think it's something that we all appreciate, even if we elect to use different lighting. So today we're going to test three popular par meters against their Lee core to help everyone get an idea of both expected accuracy, but also let you apply that to your budget so you can decide what's best for you. We're testing against a Lee core because it's generally accepted as the most accurate underwater tool available to our industry within a reasonable price range. When I say reasonable, I'm being pretty generous because the traceable NIST calibrated probe is like $750. The underwater cable alone is around $350 and more than most of the sensors we're testing today. And of course the LI-1500 itself is another $1,600. The thing that makes the Lee core the industry reference tool is because a sensor provides close to ideal response over the entire spectrum important to par, flat across most of the spectral range, and just a few percent dip at the extreme blue end. The sensors are also cosine corrected, so they're accurate even when they're not directly under the light, and the light is being measured at a fairly large angle. So obviously the Lee core meter is not a very common tool for an individual reefer. To most of us, spending a few $100 is already more than we'd like to spend. However, the Lee core is probably the best bar to measure all the rest against. I'll say right now that I don't think you should be surprised if the versions which cost 10% of the Lee core are 5 to 10% less accurate, and that should be expected. That said, there's basically no instance where a coral is going to react dramatically different to 100 par than 110. Even a difference between 200 and 220 or 300 and 330 is very unlikely to produce a significant difference, so a 10% variance really isn't a huge deal in most cases. If you're an SBS fanatic with 10 grand or more in corals in the tank, maybe picking up the highest accuracy tool available is worth it, but I think for most people, the goal is to spend as little as possible and just get into a safe range. Something that the eye just can't do. There are very few people who can visually adjust par within even 150 par throughout all areas of the tank very accurately. We're testing what I think are the three most popular par meters in our industry with the Apogee MQ210, 510, and the Senai Reef Monitor. The Apogees are handheld meters with underwater probes and differ from the older models like the 200 because they've been calibrated for underwater use. The big difference here is the MQ510 at $495 has a superior sensor which will measure the blue and red spectrums more accurately. You can see the ideal spectral response here represented by the square. The MQ510 will match it fairly well, however you can see that it's actually going to over-report for a decent portion of the range. Looking at the lower cost $375 MQ210, you can see it's under-reporting a portion of the blue and red end of the ideal spectrum response, and again will likely over-report the rest, particularly in the red end of the spectrum. Initially, this looks pretty unattractive from an accuracy standpoint, and a lot of reefers get pretty hung up on this aspect, but I suspect the difference isn't as large as you might think, and likely not enough to make a meaningful impact in a reef tank. Only other note is the MQ210 has a sun mode and an electronic mode, which has different calibrations for sun and artificial electronic light sources. There seems to be some online debate as to which mode you should use, but it's absolutely the electronic mode, something I confirmed by speaking with the Apogee engineers. The last meter we're testing is a Senai. The Senai is only $199 and monitors a variety of things, but one of them is PAR. It doesn't have the perfect spectral response curve, just like the MQ210. However, it does have something rather unique. There's an internal spectrum tool which applies a compensation variable to the PAR level based on the amount of blue, green, and red light is in the spectrum. So today I think we're going to get an idea of how accurate that approach is. I will note that the Senai isn't cosine corrected like the Apogee's and the Lecor, so it might be a bit more susceptible to errors from really wide angles near the edge of the tank, something that we'll identify today. Only other note I'll throw in here is the Senai also uses these three spectrum sensors to measure PIR in addition to PAR, which is photosynthetically usable radiation rather than just PAR or photosynthetically active radiation. The U in the center of PIR, or usable word, means it weights the red and blue ends higher because the corals are able to use these spectrums more effectively. I think in an ideal world we'd all be discussing PIR levels rather than PAR, but since very few people own PIR meters or have the ability to calculate it, I doubt we're going to see that change in the relatively near future. For now though, the Senai is opening the window to that if you'd like to take it to the next level and tweak your lighting based on PIR or PAR. For testing, we elected to use T5 lighting because most of today's LEDs tend to have some spectrum hotspots, which we wanted to avoid for a test like this. We also selected three bulb types with very different spectrum ranges to challenge the meters. The ATI Tinic, which is the blue-violet range and peaks around 425 nanometers and likely to be impacted the most by the less than ideal spectrum response of some of these meters. Similar to that, the ATI Blue Plus, which is in the blue range, which peaks around 450 and should be less affected, followed by the full spectrum Giesemann Tropic 6500K bulb. We also tested at a depth about 6 inches underwater because the Apogee's and Senai are designed to be used underwater and have calibration corrections designed for underwater use. We also tested them at all 36 points in the 30-inch cube so we could see how they perform directly under the light as well as at larger angles. It's important to know how the meters work when they're not directly under the light. So let's get to the results, starting with the Giesemann Tropic Sun. I have to tell you the results were pretty glaringly disappointing. On all 36 points, the Apogee 510 was 28% higher than the Lecor. The Apogee 210 was almost 34% higher, and the Senai came in a bit better, 21.5% higher. But overall, the disparity between the Lecor and the others was pretty huge. Behind that, we fully expected the Apogee 510 to read the blue spectrum better than the lower cost 210, and the results were quite the opposite with the 210 reading higher. So in the end, there are some pretty significant issues here, and I'll start with the Lecor. The Lecor has underwater sensors which are sold separately from the data logger, and each sensor has provided calibration factors for both air and water measurements. Because of the disparity here, we decided to test the meter's air versus water measurements, and they turned out they're producing these same numbers underwater as air, which absolutely should not be the case. The water measurements should be about 32% higher. We contacted Lecor about this issue. They were able to replicate it pretty quickly, and it turns out there is a software or firmware error which is causing the meter to ignore the water calibration settings. Something that I guess that we helped them identify this week, but was likely the case for years. So here's a big question. What does that mean about all the PAR measurements that we've shared in the last year or so? Sadly, it does mean that all of the historical data that we've shared needs to be multiplied by 1.32 to be accurate. Now, that might seem like a big deal, and to some degree it is, but all the numbers are still relative to each other and off by the same degree, so it really doesn't have a real significant impact as to comparing one light source against another, because they're all off by the same factor of 1.32. To those of you that want to throw us under the bus anyways, I'm willing to lay down in front of it for you, but before you run me over, I'd like to point out that there's PhDs and bioscientists all over the world that have been using this tool for research, and it wasn't one of them that caught and corrected this issue. It was the reefing community and BRS TV Investigates that identified this issue and why it's getting fixed for all the industries, including ours. So sad to say that wasn't the end of our problems. We also looked at the issue of the Apogee 510 reading lower than the 210, and it turned out to be the case on all three bulb spectrums, including the bluer ones, something that should not be the case. Apogee dug into this immediately as well and responded quickly by letting us know that they've identified an issue that impacts a portion of the 510 sensors. This is a fairly new product and they're all under warranty and they actively want to solve this issue, so I would certainly contact them if you already own a 510. They'll take care of you, I'm sure of it. I have to say the Apogee team and the LeCor team were both very responsive, and I was pretty impressed with how quickly they confirmed and identified the issues. So while we'd all like no issues, I think it's how you behave when things go wrong that really defines you, and they were very helpful and professional. So again, while I wish these tools didn't have issues, I'm pretty happy with the fact that this type of testing that we're doing as part of the BRS TV Investigate series is not just sharing some fun, usable information that helps with our reef tanks, but is also netting us an improvement in the quality of the products and reference tools the hobby is using. So at the end of this, we scrapped an entire week's worth of work measuring, shooting, and troubleshooting, and redid the data so we could get to the bottom of today's question, which PAR meter is the best? This time I'm going to share what my expectations are for each meter and spectrum or bulb type. Again, despite the firmware glitch, the LeCor acting as a reference tool because of the sensor's ideal response across most of the usable spectrum. You can see it's within 1-3% of the ideal response, covering almost the entire response range, other than the extreme violet range, which represents very little of the PAR in our tanks. With the Apogee 210, a lot of reefers focus on how it's underreporting the deep blue and violet spectrum. Since there's a lot of blue in a typical reef tank spectrum mix, the common conclusion is that this tool isn't accurate enough for our uses. It's my belief that since this is only impacting the extreme end of the spectrum and a portion of the light, the maximum that you're going to see is about a 15% or so variance with the bluest lights and only a few points with lights representative of how a typical reef tank is lit. One piece that's not mentioned often is if you look at the relative response, the Apogee appears to be overrepresenting most of the spectrum range outside the blue end by about 5-7%. So in reality, if you average this all out, the results might be almost the same. Sadly, we don't have a working 510 here with the higher quality sensor, so we can't provide results with that meter. I also don't know what to expect from the Senai because it uses those internal spectrum sensors to compensate for the bulb spectrum and adjust, so we'll have to see what happens. So starting with the full spectrum 65K Giesemann Tropic, we looked at the average of the four center measurement points directly under the center of the light. The LeCor reading 386 PAR, the Apogee just 2% off that at 394, but actually higher than the LeCor, not less like most reefers would expect. And the Senai reading an almost perfect 388 and only 0.4% off the LeCor. Overall, all of them reading almost identical. Now, some of you would expect the Apogee 210 to be lower, but once you consider that it's a full spectrum bulb and it's overreporting most of that spectrum by a few to 7% or so, I think the 2% high reading makes a lot of sense. In any case, I think it's pretty amazing how the Apogee in a hobby grade product performed as good as the industry leader or reference tool. One of the other elements we wanted to look at was the cosine correction, how well the sensors perform at wider angles. At the mid-range 18-inch square grid, both the Apogee 210 and the Senai were 4% higher than the LeCor and pretty accurate. At the 30-inch ring, which is outside the angle most aquarium owners would use because the majority have 2-foot or less deep tanks, the Apogee had less than a 2% difference, but the Senai was about 22% low. This is because we reached the limit of the Senai sensor's ability to read wide angles accurately because it's not cosine corrected. Keep in mind that we're using the sensor flat and the PAR does go up if you tilt it towards the light, but it's impossible for the end user to know the exact angle that they should do that at, so I would recommend keeping it flat, and that's what all of our measurements represent. So overall, the Apogee seems to work almost the same as the LeCor at pretty wide angles, and the Senai performs just a hair better than the Apogee in most of the tank, but significantly underreports at ultra wide angles. Moving on to the Blue Plus bulb, we saw pretty much the same results. In the center, the LeCor was reading 391, the Apogee 397, or 1.5% higher, and the Senai 385, or about 1.5% lower, all extremely close to each other. Similar distance or angle results as the previous test as well. In the middle 18-inch ring, the Apogee 210, 2.6% high, and almost dead on at less than 1% difference on the outer edges. The Senai was just 1% or so off at the 18-inch ring and about 23% low at the extreme outer edges of the 30-inch grid. Again, I think most reefers would have expected the Blue Plus ball to be underreported by the Apogee 210 because it's underreporting the blue spectrum. But if you look at the overlay of how much of it is being underreported versus how much is being overreported, it isn't all that shocking that it's balancing out. Lastly, looking at the ATI Atinic, which represents the extreme blue and violet end of the spectrum, this again performed as anticipated, the LeCor reading 276 PAR, the Apogee now hitting its limits in the blue spectrum and reading over 12% low, and the Senai just 4.5% low. Then at 18 inches, the Apogee 11% off and the Senai less than 1% off. The outer 30-inch portion of the grid, the Apogee 13% off and the Senai 22. So to summarize all this, I have to say that the tools perform remarkably well and inside the expectations. In fact, I think the 210 in particular performed beyond most people's expectations. And the Senai Spectrum Compensation lived up to its claims and improved accuracy over similarly priced probes across all the spectrum ranges we tested. We intentionally tested at a shallow depth of 6 inches to expose angle inaccuracies, and the Senai didn't do as well at extreme angles. However, if you measure lower in the tank, I'd expect accuracy to improve significantly. And unless you have a 30-inch deep tank and taking measurements right up on the glass, I don't think this will matter a whole lot. For 95% of you, the extreme level of accuracy within the 18-inch grid will match your needs for a tool like this. End of the day, which one do we recommend? Well, at $375, the Apogee 210 offers the most versatile use because it performs well at all angles and performed almost as good as our Lee Core, which costs almost $3,000. So it's a pretty ridiculous value from that vantage point. Frankly, the fact that it comes with a handheld meter makes it super easy to use. And if I was going to take frequent measurements, it would be my selection for sure. On the other side of this, the Senai, which is just $199 and performed really well within the normal tank constraints. However, the Senai does need to be plugged into a PC or the web server to work. If you plug it into their computer directly, it means you need a mobile laptop or a PC near the tank, or you can use their extension cable. If you leave it connected to your PC or with the web server and Wi-Fi adapter, you can use the Senai right at the tank and likely use it as a monitor as well. This is a good time to mention that the Senai not only monitors PAR, but it also monitors temperature, water level, and with disposable tabs, ammonia and pH as well. Behind that, it will email and text message you if there's ever a problem with any of these parameters. So for those of you that don't want the hassle of programming a full-on aquarium controller, the Senai is a solid 10-minute setup option, which can tell you if your heater fails, your water level is too low because your ATO return pump failed, something large died and there's an ammonia spike, or your dosing system failed and the pH is skyrocketing, all so you can save the tank. Anyways, it's kind of cool that it goes beyond just a PAR meter and does some other important elements. Also note that there's a bunch of other PAR meter brands out there that use the Apogee sensors and they look identical, so they're pretty easy to identify. Most notable is the Apex PMK PAR monitor kit. The sensor should perform exactly the same as the 210, but in this case it will track and monitor the PAR throughout the entire day. Cool element with the Apex PMK is the fact that it can give you averages or aggregate PAR based on the amount of light provided throughout the entire day. This fits in well with the DLI testing that Ecotec is doing, where 6 hours of 150 PAR might be fairly similar as 9 hours of 100. Since we're all ramping the LEDs up and down and changing the spectrum throughout the day, I think the PMK is likely the best option available if you already own an Apex or considering getting one. This video has been a pretty incredible journey for us over the last few weeks with some serious ups and downs, but hopefully we ended with the information you wanted to know. In this case, I'm dying to know what you think of everything we covered in today's episode, so please join the larger conversation on these PAR meters and the value of PAR meters in general over on our Reef to Reef thread pinned down below. As always, if you like what we're doing, give us a quick thumbs up and subscribe because we release new content like this every week. This week, we just finished setting up our T5 bulbs testing station, and we're going to be able to tell you if these bulbs really change spectrum or lose intensity over time. Really get at when do you need to change them for real. See you next week with another episode of Beerus TV Investigates.